So we have looked at point defects, and then we also said what are the different kinds of defects that we have discussed in the last class. Subatomic defects, like where you need to have an electron, and if the electron is not there in the material, then it becomes a defect for the atom, right? So that is electronic point defects. And then atomic point defects, that means the atom being present or not present, or atom being present in a wrong position where it should not be, right? And then, so this is the zero dimensional defect. And then we have said that there is going to be something called line defects, so that is 1D defects. And then you have interfacial defects, that two dimensional defects, and then volume defects, three dimensional defects. What are the length scales? When we are talking about atomic point defects, we are actually working at the order of angstroms, right? And when you are talking about line defects, you are actually talking at the scale of microns, 10 power minus 6 meters, couple of tens of nanometers or hundreds of nanometers to microns, tens of micrometers. And interfacial defects, they are actually having much higher length scale than your line defects. They can actually start from at the micron scale to millimeter scale. And then you have volume defects. Usually these volume defects can be observed with naked eye, whereas line defects and interfacial defects are usually not observable with naked eye. You need to look under a microscope to actually identify these line defects and interfacial defects. If you want to look at atomic point defects, you need to have a much more powerful microscope, right? Such as transmission electron microscope and so on. There you can actually see the individual defects, individual point defects, whether there is an atom sitting there or not. Nowadays you can actually look at the materials at that detail. All right. So now let's look at the impurities in solids. So as we have discussed, pure metals consisting of only one type of atom is just not possible. You will always have some impurities. I am not actually talking about equilibrium concentration of vacancies. I am actually talking about existence of some other material. Just iron is simply not possible. Just copper is simply not possible. If you have extremely sophisticated methods to extract these materials, you can reach up to 99.9999% of purity. Right? Even when you buy gold, they will give you the purification number, right? So that means if somebody says 99.9% purity, that means you can only, if in 1 gram of gold, 99.9% only is gold, other may be other materials, some impurities may be there, right? So at this level, there are about, at this 99.999% purity level, you can have impurity atoms of 10 power 22 to 10 power 23 in a cubic meter of material. You can have those many impurities. Yeah. And in several engineering applications, most of the metals that we are familiar with, that we are using in our engineering applications, are not pure metals. They are alloys, right? For instance, steel is an alloy of iron and carbon, bronze, right? And several materials, you may not use them in their pure form. Even when you are making your ornament, you don't make your ornament with pure gold, right? You add, what do you add to gold? So think about it. What do you add to gold? Some of you don't know. Go back and check what your goldsmith adds to gold. It is not 100% gold. Then you make a ornament. So when you add an impurity atom to your base material, then you make a solution, right? A solution is nothing but combination of two materials. You add one material to another material, together they form solution. If the state of the matter is solid, then it is called solid solution. If the state is liquid, then it is called liquid solution, right? So here in this class, we are going to talk about solid solution. Solid solution doesn't mean that it has to be a liquid. If the state of the matter is in solid, then you call this as solid solution. So when we are talking about solid solutions, you have a host and you have a guest, right? So the host is called solvent. So element or compound that is present in greatest amount is called solvent, and it is also called host. And the guy who is actually added to this solvent is called solute or guest. Solvent is the one which is the maximum proportion, which is there in the maximum proportion, and solute is the one which goes and sits there. So you add the solute to solvent. So a solid solution is formed when solute atoms are added to the host material while maintaining the system. So you observe these impurity point defects in solid solutions. A solid solution is actually something in which we intentionally add point defects, right? So if you look at, so let us say this is a crystal lattice, the green ones are your crystal lattice, and now you can see two different kinds of point defects. One point defect is a point defect is actually going and sitting in the interstitial location, then it is called interstitial impurity atom, and if it is going and sitting in the substitutional position, it is substitutional impurity atom that we have discussed already previously. And we are talking about different kinds of point defects, right? So what are different kinds of how do you actually go about forming the solid solution? So the solubility of solute atoms, so the solute atoms actually need to be need to go and sit in solvent atmosphere. That means there should be some amount of solubility for this solute atom in solvent atmosphere, right? Otherwise it cannot go and sit there. So this solubility depends on several factors. Okay, first of all, atom size factor. If what happens, what is the difference between the atomic sizes? If you are forming an interstitial solid solution, meaning all your impurity atoms are actually going and sitting in the interstitial locations of your solvent cloud, that such a solid solution is called interstitial solid solution. If your solute atoms are going and sitting in the substitutional positions, they are actually going to substitute for your solvent atoms, then such a solid solution is called substitutional solid solution. Okay, so when do you form a substitutional solid solution or interstitial solid solution? That actually depends on several factors. One of the important factors is atomic size factor. When the difference between, difference in the atomic radii sizes is less than 15%, only then you will be able to form substitutional solid solution. Otherwise you will form interstitial solid solution, or you will create lattice distortion. And for a good solid solubility, the solvent atom and solute atom should be having same crystal structure. If they have similar crystal structure, then the solubility is better, and their electronegativity values should be as close as possible. They should not have a large difference in their electronegativity, and the valence is also another important thing. So metals will have more tendency to dissolve another metal of higher valence, right? While all other factors being equal, it actually tries to. So this is not the primary thing. When all other things are satisfied, then it will look for a metal to dissolve, a metal which has higher valence than itself. Okay, so one very good example for substitutional solid solution is copper nickel system. Copper and nickel are completely soluble in each other at all proportions. If you take 90% copper, 10% nickel, and vice versa, so they are completely soluble in each other, right? And it forms a substitutional solid solution. You can see why. The copper atom radius is 0.128, nickel atom radius is 0.12. they are very close to each other. That is why their solubility is, first of all, they are close to each other, and hence they will only form substitutional solid solution, right? Because the interstitial sites are going to be smaller for them, because the atom sizes are almost same. Both are FCC, and their electronegativity values are also very close, 1.9 and 1.8. and hence they form a very good substitutional solid solution with almost complete solubility, 100% solubility in each other. Other examples for substitutional solid solutions are copper, gold, gold silver, nickel palladium, lead, tin, bismuth and so on, right? And what are the examples for interstitial solid solution? So when do you have interstitial solid solution? When the guest atom or the solute atom size is smaller, much smaller than the solvent cloud, and then it actually can go and sit in the interstitial positions. So impurity atoms fill the voids or interstices among the solute solvent cloud or host material. Okay. So, but the when you have an interstitial solid solution, you cannot actually have complete solubility. Here you have the maximum allowable concentration of an interstitial impurity in general is only about 10%. You cannot actually dissolve a material which will form an interstitial solid solution more than 10% concentration. Okay? So for instance, carbon forms an interstitial solid solution with iron. So steel is an interstitial solid solution of iron and carbon. And the maximum allowable, so maximum solubility of carbon in iron is 2%, not more than 2%, right? So you see that atomic radius of iron is 0.124 and this guy is much smaller, 0.071, and that is the reason why it actually can nicely go and sit in the interstitial locations. And the maximum carbon concentration of carbon in iron is about 2%. 2 point something, so about 2%. And if you carefully look at it, the interstitial, suppose iron can occur in two forms, right? You have alpha iron and gamma iron, right? Alpha iron is BCC while gamma iron is FCC. You will have two different crystal structures. It changes its phase depending on the temperature and composition. So if you look in BCC material, iron lattice, you will see that the interstitial site radius is 0.036 nanometers by knowing the radius of iron. And if it is FCC, then you have 0.053 nanometers. Alright. So please note that the carbon is actually going and sitting in the interstitial site, but the size of carbon atom is actually larger than any of these, right? So when actually carbon goes and sits, it sort of disturbs the crystal lattice locally. It will create local distortion and hence the energy of the crystal might change because of the local distortion. Alright. Yes. We will discuss about it when we are talking about phase diagram. Yeah? At this point of time, I am not discussing that, but we will discuss when we are talking about phase diagram. The question is, why does iron change its crystal structure when you go from one temperature to another temperature or composition? Right? That's what I said. Iron has, we call alpha iron at low temperatures and gamma iron at little high temperatures, and again much higher temperatures, again it becomes delta iron BCC again. So why does it change crystal structure? We will discuss maybe in this towards the second end of this course. Yeah. Okay. Now you have a solid solution, and now how do we specify the composition or concentration? So the relative content of a specific element or a constituent in an alloy is called the composition. Okay. So you can describe this composition as weight percentage or atom percentage. What do you mean by weight percentage? How, what is the meaning of weight percentage? The weight of a particular element relative to the total weight of the alloy. What is the atom percentage? Instead of weight, you only talk about the number of atoms, right? The fraction of number of atoms, then it is called atom percentage. We will see the definition in a moment. So the composition of an element 1 in an, suppose if you have a binary alloy, what do you mean by binary alloy? You have only two elements, one solid and one solvent. Okay, if you have a binary alloy made of element atoms 1 and 2, the composition weight percentage, in weight percentage can be defined as m1 over m1 plus m2 times 100. So that is the regular definition that you have studied in your high school before coming here, right? If you want to define atom percentage, number of moles of an element in relation to the total moles of the element in elements in the alloy. So number of moles can be defined as mass of that particular species divided by the atomic weight of that particular species, and hence atom percentage can be defined as NM1, that is number of moles of atom type 1 divided by the total number of moles, that is NM1 plus NM2, right? So you can define, so you can actually express the composition either in weight percentage or in atom percentage. So when you look at these composition diagrams, you will either have weight percentage or atom percentage, sometimes you will have both of them. So if you draw the diagram, on the bottom x axis you will have weight percentage, on the top x axis you will have atom percentage. So in the same diagram you can see, you can actually make this, you can read the diagram either in terms of weight percentage or atom percentage. Okay. So I am not going to discuss these derivations, but you should be able to convert from one to the other by knowing the atomic weights of these materials. Okay. Okay. So to here I am not going through that, we will do through tutorials, but the slides are there, so you can actually go through the slides. Okay, so that is about point defects. So what did we learn so far? Now can we list different types of defects in a solid? Yes or no? Louder. Can we calculate the equilibrium concentration of vacancies in a material at a specific temperature given the relevant formation energy? We can calculate. Can we derive the expression for equilibrium concentration of vacancies? Can we list different types of solid solutions? Today we have looked at substitutional solid solutions and interstitial solid solutions. And can we give at least 5 different examples for each? We have already given 5 examples for substitutional solid solutions: copper, gold, gold, silver, right? And I have given you one example for interstitial solid solution, but you should be able to go back and find out what are the other materials which forms interstitial solid solutions, other alloys that you are familiar with are actually interstitial solid solutions. And you, what are the conditions for the formation of either a substitutional solid solution or an interstitial solid solution? So we have looked at the atomic size factor, electronegativity, what else, valency, state and crystal structure. So these are the things. So based on that you can actually decide whether a material is, a particular system is more probable to form a substitutional solid solution or an interstitial solid solution. And we should be able to calculate weight and atomic percentage of elements of an alloy. If you know the volume fractions, then you should be able to calculate weight and atom percentage. Okay. So that is what we have looked at so far. So we have looked at the zero dimensional defects. Now we need to focus our attention on line defects or one dimensional defects. Okay. So these line defects are also called dislocations. So what are the concepts that we are going to learn in this module? First of all, you should be able to draw a schematic of an edge, screw and mixed dislocation and identify Burgess vector. And we should be able to draw schematics, we should be able to list different kinds of grain boundaries and draw schematics of these grain boundaries. And explain the role of grain boundaries on dislocation motion. And can we explain with the knowledge gained until here to explain the strength of nanocrystalline materials compared to their coarse grained counterparts. Why a nanocrystalline material is much stronger than the coarse grained counterpart. Okay, nanocrystalline copper is stronger than normal copper, polycrystalline copper, normal copper. Why is that? Will we be able to explain that? And what are the different types of strengthening mechanisms? What do we mean by strengthening? We will discuss. So we should be able to list different types of strengthening mechanisms and plot the schematic variation of these mechanical properties as a function of weight percentage of alloying elements. We have just now seen that you have a substitutional solid solution and interstitial solid solution, and depending on the composition, how your mechanical properties change. And finally, you should be able to derive the expression for critically resolved shear stress to talk about plastic deformation in a material. All right. Okay, I'll just introduce you to the concept of the line defects, and then we'll stop. Okay, so that we can again start at the same point tomorrow. We know that the stress required, as we have discussed in yesterday's class as well as in today's class, the stress required to plastically deform a crystal is much less than the stress calculated for a theoretical shear strength. They have calculated, turns out to be much larger than the real shear strength of the material. So the shear strength, the reason why we call that represents the plastic deformation is basically because your this atom, one atom which is in contact with a set of atoms, is actually going away from these atoms. So that means this, the neighbors of these atoms are changing, right? When you are before applying the shear stress, if you remember this picture, for instance, this atom A here, right? When it moves, when you are applying the shear stress, this atom A is actually in contact with this first atom here, but when you are applying shear stress, this atom A actually moves to the position B, right? And then its neighbor is changed. That means there is a breakage of bond, and that means once you remove the shear stress there, it will never be able to come back to its original configuration, and that is what we call plastic deformation. Plastic deformation is non-reversible, whereas elastic deformation is reversible. When you are applying load, external load to a material, first what you do is you actually stretch the bonds before you break them. Before breaking them, if you remove the load, then the bond, elastic bond, is retained, and hence it will come back to its original configuration. That is the reason why under elastic regime, within the elastic regime, when you remove the load, the material comes back to its original configuration. But when you are going past that area, then what you are actually doing is you are actually breaking the bond here. Once you break the bond, energy is dissipated, and then after that, if you remove the load, it cannot come back because that energy is dissipated in terms of heat and the bond is broken. It is an irreversible process, right? So that is what we call plastic deformation. So the stress required to plastically deform a crystal, the theoretical shear strength, in other words, is actually much larger than the real strength of the material. And it turns out that if you impart plastic deformation to a material, the further deformation requires higher stress. That means after plastically deforming a material requires higher stress to subsequent deformation. And that is what is called work hardening. We will talk about why that thing happens, such thing happens. Okay. So these dislocations are actually nothing but line defects, and how do they look like and how do they move in a crystal is something that we will look in the next week. Okay. Good. Tomorrow you have a tutorial in MSB 243. All of you should be going there, not here. And the tutorial starts at 5, right? 4:50 or 5? They have changed the time. They didn't change the time for this. Okay, whatever. We are ready. We'll be there by 4:50. I will not be there. Professor Manoj Pandey and the TS will be there. So they will take care of the tutorial, and the tutorial questions will be uploaded this night. Around 6 we will upload. Please have a look at them before coming to the class, but don't write the answers in your rooms. You have to come here and write the answers in the class. Okay?